Welcome to Creativity in the Time of COVID. This program is a love letter to Temple Bethel of Boca Raton and the Jewish community around the world, featuring your creativity, music, and great conversations with creative voices from our time. Emmy award-winning comedian Judy Gold, celebrity chef Michael Solomonov, Tony award-winning producer Jonathan Demar, Oscar winner Elinor Burkett, film producer Jess Weiss, actress Alyssa Marvin, and marketing guru Brandon Schuster. But first, our clergy.
Because I knew you, because I knew you, I have been changed for good.
Lori, I love that song. You played that so magnificently. It's so beautiful and powerful.
Thank you so much. I've actually been playing a lot of piano these days. I've never played piano for myself and sung at the same time. But since we've been broadcasting services, I've had to practice and develop a whole new skill set. What have you been doing during this time that's creative?
I've had to learn all kinds of new technologies. And in order to prepare for classes, I've learned a ton of really interesting things, been playing a ton of guitar. And I think I've spent more time cooking this last 2 months than maybe in the last 20 years. Amy's been leading a discussion for her book club. Meredith is still taking violin lessons with her teacher in St. Louis. Ellie is dancing up a storm even online. It's amazing to see how creative people are. Rabbi Greg, what's going on in your house?
Well, we have been doing a lot of art projects in my house. There are markers, there are crayons, there are colored pencils all over. We've been building with Legos. Claire and I have been working on our piano. She's taking lessons and I'm playing here and there. And in the kitchen, we have been doing lots and lots of baking.
From the moment that the Torah begins, God creates and sees that creating is good. So God keeps creating and creating and creating. And here we are with this amazing world that we live in. We have many ways that we express creativity in our home, from listening to music, to dancing, to telling stories, and of course, lots and lots of singing. We have a giant table out on our patio that's filled with art projects and crayons and Play-Doh. But recently, we've been learning online how to do things that we might not have known how to do before. And I wanted to share with you this picture that my daughter Leora made just by watching a sketch art class online. By the way, Rabbi Greg, I'm still waiting for some of those baked goods you guys are making.
Sometimes it is in the most difficult of circumstances that we create our best stuff. Look at Vincent van Gogh and the amazing art he produced even after he cut off his ear.
Hey, don't get any ideas.
It really is true. I just read an article by Rabbi Shmuley Yanklowitz about Judaism and creativity, and he reminds us that it's at the moment of despair when it seems that there are no answers left that our unique human capacity for perseverance and creativity really kicks in.
That's absolutely true. In our house, we have been enjoying some of the amazing creativity that art houses around the world have been creating and putting out. We've gone on to museum websites to see the collections they've made available. We watched the Disney sing-along and plays by Andrew Lloyd Webber and from the Shakespeare Globe Theater that have made it available to the public. Just a few days ago, my girls and I watched a production of Bolero put together by students at Juilliard and some alumni and edited into one amazing video. In this moment, when there's been so much loss and so much hurt and so much pain, it has been amazing to see how much creative good there has been.
In creating during COVID, what really motivates me is when I get on my bike every morning and I'm so grateful and amazed by the trees and the sky and all the things that are created in nature by God. And I find myself saying the Yotzer, the prayer in the morning where we thank God for creation and ongoing creation. And that's where creativity happens, because of that ongoing creation is up to us as God's partners.
And here's something that's even a little bit closer to home. David Ascalon and Ascalon Studios, that created so much of the art at Temple Bethel's Schaefer Family Campus, are not able to fully produce the art that they normally do. So instead, they've turned their artist quarters over to manufacture the COVID-19 intubation safety box. It's an acrylic cube-shaped form that's positioned over an infected patient's head and their upper torso so as to minimize the spread of infection. And I've seen our congregants do incredibly creative things that have made a difference in the lives of so many other people. And they give so selflessly of themselves to make our world a safer and a better place. It's so amazing and inspiring. Creativity is in abundance during this difficult time, for sure.
Exactly. That's why I reached out to two of the most creative people that I know. Our own Brandon Schuster, who was raised here at Temple Beth-El and is a marketing guru. I wanted to put him in conversation with my Oscar-winning friend and all-around brilliant journalist, filmmaker, and philanthropist who divides her time between New York and Zimbabwe, Elinor Burkett. Turns out the two of them are so creative and so connected that we have assembled a program to delve into what creativity looks like right now. Did you see the Saturday Night Seder? Celebrities and rabbis were side by side in their own homes making creative content to tell the Passover story. It was perhaps one of the earliest and most significant moments for the Jewish community in this pandemic. Let's explore with some of the leading voices what creative content looks like for the Jewish community and the world at large with creativity during COVID. Hi, I thought it was appropriate to be standing in my kitchen while talking to Michael Solomonov, one half of the trailblazing Philadelphia Hospitality Group cook and solo. He's winner of several James Beard Awards, including Best Chef of 2017 and Zahav, the pioneering Israeli restaurant, put the food of Israel on the map. And Michael, talking to you at this time is just a ray of light in these difficult times. And your proud Aunt Aileen is a beloved member of Temple Beth-El. So I want to start, how are you doing right now? And what are you working on right now?
Well, thanks so much for having me. And it's good to be able to connect. Albeit I like to hug and, you know, I'm a kisser. So I guess doing it through a screen is a little weird, but thank you in any case. What am I working on right now? I mean, what we're doing is frantically, my business partner, Steve, and I are every day, multiple times a day, sort of putting together different scenarios on which we can reopen, how to keep the staff healthy, safe, employed, in good spirits, and try to also stay sort of busy.
I want to ask you about the Saturday Night Seder. I loved you and Dan Levy on the Saturday Night Seder that showed during Passover. It was really early in the timeline of people being at home and things beginning to be produced at home. What was your experience of being part of that?
Well, it's so funny because I had just started watching Schitt's Creek like now. You know, I don't watch a lot of TV and I've obviously been watching a lot more than I have. And so I was like falling in love with his character and with the show and with the message. And so a friend of mine, Sass, was one of the producers and one of the writers. And she and I had met years ago at this Jewish film festival. Like we shared a cab from New York to Connecticut and we became tight on that ride. And then she calls me randomly and says, hey, we're doing this thing. It's going to benefit the CDC. Would you do this do a Seder plate, a virtual Seder plate with an actor? And I was like, sure. And originally it wasn't supposed to be Dan. It was, I don't even remember who it was, but it was still very cool. And I was like, I don't even know how I'm involved in this, you know, because I'm certainly not as cool as any of these people. And then I got another email saying, oh, just so you know, it's going to be Dan Levy. And I was like, oh my God, I'm watching. I love him, you know? So it was amazing. It was cool. And I'll tell you what, like being part of that, I mean, it was great. It was fun. I felt like probably every one of us so conflicted and so disconnected. And for every Jewish holiday, every time we bake challah and break bread and say the prayers and go through any, especially for Pesach, the emptiness that we all sort of feel that we have to fight against was sort of front and center of emotion, you know, and being, having to spend a chag by yourself is just not what Jews do. Secular to Orthodox to observant, we're together through thick and thin, through good, through bad, we're always sort of together. So to be alone, or to be without family and to be without tradition as we know it, is just a weird thing. And then, you know, so I was like, great, this is a way for me to actually make a Seder plate, because I was going to eat a bowl of matzo ball soup. And that would have been it, you know? So to be part of it was great. And then I have to say, objectively speaking, like, it was so well done. It was so, like, the Saturday Night Seder, I think, was, there isn't anybody I spoke to that wasn't in tears over it, you know? And it really fulfilled a purpose that I think that we all sort of needed.
What is creativity looking like in the culinary world? You alluded to what you're doing with your team to try and figure out what each day looks like day by day. What are you seeing in creativity at large in the culinary world?
You know, there are tens of millions of people that are unemployed now in the hospitality industry, and it happened overnight. So creative means everything. Creative means pumping your staff up and getting people engaged. It means cooking as much as you can and sort of celebrating what it means to be quarantined right now, spending as much time as you can with your family, which is not historically a luxury that people in hospitality have had. And then really trying to engage with government, whether it be local or even federal. There's now an independent restaurant coalition. Like, we have lobbyists in Washington now, and we never did before. And it's about time, you know? I mean, it represents such a huge section of American economy. It doesn't make sense that we wouldn't. So creativity is all those things. I will say, from a personal standpoint, really having to define what it means for you to stay positive every single day has taken a lot of creativity. And I think that's something that we are all struggling with.
I want to go to Israel for a second, a place that is so a part of your family's history and we hold dear in our heart, and your family's story in our heart. How are you staying connected to Israel right now?
Well, I mean, I do have family, and I do have like very good friends and community there. And actually, you know, I've had more time now to connect, and it, these aren't just like WhatsApp or DM five sentences. You know, I FaceTime very regularly. I've done a couple Instagram live, like cooking things with chefs and friends in Israel. And really, you know, we had a culinary tour scheduled for this May. Actually it would be in 10 days. We were supposed to go to Israel, and, that's obviously going to be rescheduled, but really trying to figure out what next fall looks like and next winter looks like as well, to start driving people back to Israel to help sort of stimulate the economy there.
My last question, I'm standing in my kitchen. I've been spending way more time in my kitchen than I ever have. Are there any great Israeli dishes you can recommend for us to make while we are at home?
That's a great question. So I think that a couple things that you can do that are very simple is taking a head of cauliflower and taking off all the florets and seasoning it with salt, turmeric, black pepper, and cumin, and letting it just cure at room temperature, right? So you take the florets off the core and you toss it with the salt and the spice mixture, and you let it sit for 2-3 hours at room temperature, so it really cures and absorbs. And then you roast it with olive oil, and then just serve it with garlic and Greek yogurt and garlic sort of sauce. I think it's perfect. And it's like hot where you are, right?
It's very hot. It's like almost 90, yeah.
Not hot here, but I feel like that with the sort of chilled, it's got like the, instead of the French onion dip, you've got this sort of Greek yogurt and garlic dip for roasted cauliflower. I think I would definitely do that.
It sounds awesome. I want to thank you so much for being with us as part of our Creativity in the Time of COVID special. I want to wish you well and your all the employees, all your customers, everything that you do. And thank you so much for being with us. We really appreciate it.
To you all, and best to you and your congregation. And a special shout out to Auntie Lean. And all of you guys, thank you so much for having me. You know, Tia Chazak, and I'll see you guys soon. All right? Cheers.
Fantastic. Thank you, Michael. Take care. Bye-bye.
Creativity, Yetzaratiyut in Hebrew, is the ultimate expression of the human spirit. It wells up in celebration of special moments and leads us to discover not only hidden talents, but hidden truths. It challenges the ordinary and moves us on to a better world. During difficult moments, creativity raises our spirit, all the while digging deep inside to reflect pain as beauty. Even in times of strife and uncertainty, creativity flourishes. Shakespeare wrote King Lear during waves of plagues in London. Baruch Spinoza, the eminent Jewish thinker, wrote great works during the bubonic plague. And the famed Jewish composer Gustav Mahler composed his greatest music during the cholera epidemic. So it's hardly surprising that during this modern pandemic, creativity is exploding. For Passover, singers, actors, and rabbis teamed up to broadcast an extraordinary Saturday night Seder. And from their bedrooms, basements, and offices, the cast of Saturday Night Live found ways to make us laugh. But the creativity fueled at this time isn't confined to all-star entertainment. Across India and Africa, painters and cartoonists are spreading information about the need for social isolation. And here, members of our Temple Bethel community are contributing to the creative output that is the record of what we are living. What you see here are our own congregants being creative in these times. The coronavirus might be easily transmitted, but viruses are not the only infection in our atmosphere. As Albert Einstein once said, creativity is contagious. Pass it on.
Well, hi, everybody. I am Jonathan Demar. I am a co-producer of Hadestown, which is the Tony Award-winning show of the story of Orpheus and Eurydice that unfortunately got shut down due to COVID-19. And I'm here with Alyssa. Alyssa Marwin, tell me about yourself and your show.
I was a part of Trevor the Musical. We were still in rehearsals while all this COVID shutdown hit. Trevor is about, you know, forging your own path during adolescence and the power of acceptance. And, you know, it's really about just living life with a ton of passion and, you know, also a little bit of pizzazz.
So your show got closed down, obviously. You were going to be in this off-Broadway show. What was it like for all of that to happen?
It was pretty rough, honestly. You know, we were really close to being into tech rehearsals. So we were like just finishing up learning the show, and then it just sort of hit. And it had been such like a long process, you know, to get into the show, something like 10 rounds of auditions, maybe. So, you know, it just, it really hurt just seeing it all sort of go away just like that. Like there wasn't, you know, any closure. It just sort of, you know, just disappeared one day, and that was that.
I remember being your age and being on Broadway, and that was always such a special time. But you've had like quite an incredible resume. You've been on tour with School of Rock and all of these like different shows. So would this been like your first New York show?
I've done some like off Broadway things before, but this is definitely like the biggest, or it would have been the biggest New York show that I've done here.
Like how many are in your cast?
There is 19 people in total, and 13 of them are kids.
And that's a pretty unique thing, because rarely, yeah. I mean, I remember when I did Christmas Carol, we had maybe, I think, 5 to 6 kids in that show, and everybody else was adults. So that's a pretty cool thing that like the majority of your cast are all kids. Is that a cool thing to kind of tap into?
Yeah, it's really fun too, because, you know, I get to, you know, make so many new friends with them. And, you know, really, they're just friendships that I know will last a lifetime with me. So it's really incredible.
So I know you're a really good singer. I've seen your stuff on YouTube. What's a favorite song that you like to sing?
Oh my God. So many songs. I love so many things.
You were on tour with School of Rock, and there was an anthem that I know the rabbi really liked.
Yes. Yeah. If only you would listen. It's a really great song.
Oh, that's awesome. Do you mind singing a little bit?
Oh yeah, of course. I've got so much to say, if only you would listen. I've tried every which way, and still you never listen. Can't you see I'm hurting? I couldn't be more clear. But I promise one day I'll make you hear.
Oh, you're great. Oh, my goodness. I see big things for you.
Yeah,
that's a wonderful voice. Well, you certainly have you have so much potential already, and I can't wait to see what happens next with your amazing career.
Yes, yeah, I'm excited to see what happens with Hadestown and with everything you do in the future.
Thank you. Well, this was wonderful. I'm glad we got to do this, and really nice to meet you.
Yes, it was very nice to meet you too.
עוד יש מפרס לבן באופק מובנן שחור כבד כל שנבקש נועיל ועם החלונות הערב אור נרון אחד רועד כל שנבקש
have assembled a dream team of creative people to reflect on creativity in the time of COVID. We are honored to have with us comedian and two-time Emmy winner Judy Gold, New York-based Tony Award-winning producer and actor Jonathan Demar, film and theater producer Jess Weiss, marketing executive and one of Temple Bethel's own Brandon Schuster, and journalist and Oscar-winning filmmaker and old-fashioned storyteller, Elinor Burkett. Their full bios can be found on Temple Bethel of Boca Raton's website, tbeboca.org. And now, here's our panel.
Thank you, Rabbi Jessica. You know, it's really hard to even imagine that only 2 months ago, our world's completely changed. But even during such a tough time, and even with all of the negatives, we have seen a silver lining to all of this. We have seen a lot of positive creativity that's come during this time, and in a lot of different ways, it's actually helped us feel more connected across so many different worlds, even if we can't physically be with each other in person. thousands and thousands of incredible and unusual pieces of art and content have already helped define what creativity means during the time of COVID. And tonight, I am so excited for you guys to hear about some of our favorites and how this time might impact art and content after quarantine. I am so honored to have the opportunity to speak with this incredible award-winning panel. I am seriously pinching myself, and I can't believe that I'm actually doing it in my childhood bedroom of all places. So I would like to start with this very question. What's going on? A lot of our during COVID, and it's a crazy time, which has impacted us all. And so, Jess, I actually want to start with you. You know, you have years of experience working on film, TV, and commercial sets. So, how has this impacted your work?
Thanks, Brendan. So everything is basically shut down right now. Production stopped around March 16th, and that was worldwide. Everybody and myself as a producer is working diligently to figure out how we can bring production back to set, but it truly takes a village and it makes it really hard to do when we're social distancing. Yeah. So we're all figuring out what are the new measures of safety that we need to get, whether that is a coronavirus apartment, whether that is getting everybody to quarantine together for 2 weeks before everything restarts again. We'll figure it out as the time goes. Every day comes with a new strategy. That being said, development is booming like we've never seen before because they're looking for new content and agencies are waiting more than ever. And in figuring out the new streaming strategies, we'll see where our lives will go.
Yeah, totally. And so, Jonathan, you're actually kind of on the opposite end of the spectrum. You have helped produce some of the most beloved Broadway shows over the past couple of years. How has the theater world been dealing with COVID?
Well, thank you for having me. It's really awesome to be part of this. You know, I think the big thing about Broadway and more so the theater community is that it really is a community and it's full of a lot of people with empathy. So, you know, when disaster strikes, people come together and support so many causes. You know, we tell these stories, we're putting ourselves in other people's shoes. So it just seems natural for us to help other people. I know Celia Keenan-Bolger is doing something with Bellevue in terms of a food drive. We're raising money for the Actors Fund. We're doing tons of streaming things in that realm. And just, you know, helping each other and really lifting each other up. I think the thing that we're not doing is speculating when we're coming back as much because we know right now things are so uncertain. But, you know, while we're kind of waiting to see what information we can get because of the fact we would be in these live spaces, we're just trying to figure out how to help each other and provide content for people all over the world.
Yeah, totally. And Judy, you know, aside from me knowing you personally, you are seriously, and I truly mean this, one of the funniest people ever. I truly, truly mean that.
Thank you.
Of course. And, you know, I definitely miss the thrill of seeing you perform live. And so I'm very curious to know how this time has affected you and other comedians, you know, while we are all in quarantine.
Well, thank you for asking that. And it is an honor to be with these people. And I did make that challah last night, and that's why it's in the background, because that is something I never would have done if we weren't in quarantine, because usually Friday nights I have to go perform. But it's been really weird for comics because I feel like it's one of the only art forms where you really need an audience to even do your work, to even develop your material. So, and I think everyone who watches late night TV or has been watching Saturday Night Live realize that it does not translate well without an audience. So it's been really weird. Someone started a virtual comedy club and I'm sort of curious as to how that's going. You know, you have Zoom people who can, you know, react, But I think everyone here can attest to the fact nothing compares to live performance. Nothing. Zero. Which is why I, you know, people often say, you know, oh, I've been a comic, a stand-up, because I love live performance. I love it more than any other sort of, I love TV and I love film, but there's nothing that compares to it. And it's, I think we're all really, and when I talk to the other comics, it's, we don't know what to do. I've never gone this long without getting on stage and doing a set. And as a comic, you know, I go out 5 nights a week because if it's like a muscle, if you don't do it, if you're not on stage all the time doing your material, you get out of shape. And I'm sort of terrified. I'm very terrified, but I've been keeping busy, but I'm still terrified.
Totally. And you know, comedy is all about telling stories and stories which make us laugh. And Elinor, you know, you have traveled all around the world to help bring us some of the most important and incredible stories. And so, whether it's through documentary or nonfiction print, I'm very curious to know how storytelling has changed since we all kind of entered into this crazy, crazy time that we can't even make sense of.
You know, I think it's harder. It's hard for me because I've never told exactly stories that make people happy. Well, my stories tend to be stories about people who maybe they're overcome, but they are suffering. And this is a very hard time to tell people stories about other people who are suffering more than they are. Because I don't think anybody wants to hear about anybody suffering more than New Yorkers, for instance. So my husband and I run an orphan center in Zimbabwe. So I would love to be writing or filming about the fact this is a country in lockdown where everybody is being told to wash their hands, but there's water once every 6 days at 2 o'clock in the morning from a public tap. And there's no food, so you can't exactly stock up your groceries at home and not go out. But you think anybody wants to hear that story right now? About how things are worse for somebody else? I don't think so.
Okay, so but I think we all need to go now that they run an orphanage in Zimbabwe. Like, why am I even here? Seriously.
Yeah. Yeah, right.
Bye. Take care,
about,
guys.
Because you will make us, you know, I was thinking about what you said before, Jonathan, about, and what you both said about live audiences. And I was thinking about the Seder. The Seder was really funny. They were their own audience. You all entertain us. And I don't want to minimize that. Because right now, everyone is so stressed. And I spent an hour and a half watching that Seder and I laughed my butt off. And I felt joy the whole time. And so you will bring us joy. I don't bring joy.
Well, Elinor, that's not true. I don't, oh, Jess, can I just say one thing? You made me think of this, I wrote a book that's coming out in July called Yes, I Can Say That, When They Come For the Comedians, We're All in Trouble. And it's all about freedom of speech from the perspective of a comedian. And when you talk about those stories that are sad that people don't want to hear, you know, I have been thinking about how jokes about COVID and the situation we're in now are going to age and what's going to be funny, because what was funny about COVID in March is not funny in May. And how is this stuff going to age? What are we going to be able to laugh at? And it's a really a slippery slope.
Yeah. And on that note, I think that we're all as content creators, we're all wondering what, it's not like what will make people laugh or what will sell, but it's like, will people want dramas after this? Will they just want comedy and rom-coms and
right.
Something that will be light because that's all we need? Or are we really going to go into movies like Contagion and it's going to be Contagion 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 because we're
right.
Different pandemic?
No, we have enough Contagion. Nobody's going to want Contagion.
I know. No one wants to watch that.
That's right. We
did it. Easy to make because I can put people at social distancing right now.
And when you think about Jess, you think about the flappers of the 20s, you know, we're in the same exact, it was a whole cultural phenomenon. I feel like that's what's going to happen. Who knows?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Who knows is the right question to be asking. Yeah.
So I think in theater, it's going to be the same thing because we are going to want things that lift people up. Obviously, you're going to have the shows that have been successful still there, but I think we're not going to have as, there will be perspective. I think always theater does have the perspective, but it's going to be based on what people, you know, are going to feel comfortable seeing. And I think that's something we have to consider when we're creating new shows for next year and the years to come, naturally.
You know, it's so, I was talking to my manager about this yesterday, to stand there, to be the performer on stage, and the laughter or the reactions are, you know, with people, because when you're doing stand-up, when you're watching a play, you're, whoever you came with is so much part of the experience for you, especially in stand-up, and to not be able to say, oh my God, that's funny. Oh, that reminds me of blah, blah, blah. I love this song. Whatever it is, you know, is it going to be a solitary event for people? You know, I'll see you after the show. I agree with Jonathan, until there's a vaccine.
I mean, we can't even stage door because, and one of the things that was so smart, which Hadestown did, is like on the first outbreak of this, we were the first show to say, we're not doing a stage door. We're going to be careful. And other shows started following suit. And then once the Virginia Woolf usher and the Six usher got it, I think there were calls for me personally, a lot of people in the industry saying, let's shut down because it just doesn't make sense.
Yeah. The Comedy Cellar that last week, which was the week of my last show I did live was in Minneapolis, and it was for Purim. It was a Purim spiel. It was for a synagogue, you know, and little did I know I was booked that weekend at the Comedy Cellar, and I was, do I go? Do I not go? They would wash the mic. Every comic had their own mic. So a comic would get off stage. Someone would disinfect that mic. And then the next comic would go, and I still didn't feel comfortable.
Jess, so obviously people are probably going to be worried going back to movie theaters, but also streaming is at levels that we've never seen before. What could this possibly mean for the movie theater versus streaming war, essentially?
Exactly. I mean, there are a couple of points on what was said before, that it's, what is interesting about film is that there are several stages, right? There's the production stage, in which we actually have to make the material, and then we have to distribute it and show it to the audiences. So production is the biggest question of how we would even continue to create content as is in the social distancing world. As far as the distribution, the same way as theaters and comedy clubs, theaters are still very much about the laughter and very much about the joint community experience. And there are several movies that are going to skip that. And there are several movies that are going to wait. For example, In the Heights, which is a movie that I'm super excited about. It's very musical. It's very much about the experience. It should wait for a theater. It has to be that live, beautiful moment with everybody there. That being said, we're also we're also in that intimate living room space with everybody there. But with all the streaming services that we have, Netflix, Hulu, Amazon, Disney, Apple, whatever else, they're going to run out of content before December. So we're seeing the streaming services really looking for content right now. And the question is whether they are finally going to start paying attention to independent films that maybe were on the shelf for years now, but hey, we're ready to sell. And the other catch too is we're going to see a lot of other new services coming. Like Lincoln Center came out with a new service.
Yeah.
Kino Now came out with a new one. And they're trying to recreate that movie theater experience at home, in which you buy a ticket and you have maybe 5 days to see it. It's also cheaper. So maybe we're going to see that model working out well for families that want to see a movie. And the funniest one that I'm seeing the resurgence of is drive-thrus.
Yes.
Right now, and I have never been to a drive-thru in my life.
But they're closed. I mean, I live in an area where there are drive-ins and they're not allowed to open.
Yeah, ours, we have one here on Cape Cod and it hasn't been open. But, you know, I looked online and every, you know, they're just so whiny, you know. What if they, because they have service, if they order food and the window's open? I'm like, shut up. You're not even Jewish. You're not allowed to talk like that.
You know, I wanted to add to what Jess said about content. What has most captured my attention about content is the internationalization of content.
Yes.
If we look at something like Unorthodox, if not for this moment, would it have hit so big? The new season of Fauda. And I'm just using Israeli ones because after all, we're a synagogue. But if I were, you know, I could use lots of others. So I think what's interesting about content for me is that Americans who never would have seen international films or series, all of a sudden, are seeing, they're opened up to a much wider world. And that's exciting.
I'm a purist, you know, like I am a comic who loves to, as we said, loves to be in front of the audience. And there are so many comedians, younger comedians, who were getting gigs in clubs because they were doing videos, small, you know, and these club bookers would just book them because they knew they'd sell out. The comics were not experienced enough to headline a show, but the bookers, a lot of them didn't care. They'd be like, all right, fine, they'll do one weekend. And so for those comedians, those younger comedians who had been using video to get followers and get booked, you know, they're thriving, I guess, doing their videos. But, and it's us who were the people going out with our notebooks and writing our jokes and being on stage, that we, it's such a weird place to be figuring out how do we do what we do and translate it so that it's a similar experience, but it's not.
But yeah. Even on that note, with the what Elinor was saying about internationalization, even Saturday Night Seder, fun fact, I'm Brazilian, and I send to everyone I know in Brazil, watch this right now. It's on YouTube. Everybody watched it. So it also opens your audience a lot because everything is happening live. Everything is happening online. And the laws of distribution are still very unclear as to, like, you know, the geo tags and like, oh, this is only going to be open for the United States. No, everything has become very worldwide. And we're seeing, like, you know, a lot of streaming services opening themselves up for international audiences. Like, you know, I think the Israel Philharmonic, the Berlin Philharmonic, the Paris Philharmonic, the New York Philharmonic, we can see all their works, like the world can see their works as opposed to before COVID, in which, no, I physically have to go to the Lincoln Center. And if you live in France, you can't. So that's also a very interesting new
shift. That's true about museums. That's true about all kinds of things.
Right.
It's so I think those traditional institutions are going to have to remake themselves or die.
Yeah.
But they have new audiences. This is giving people, I do a lot of work with a synagogue in New York that has a large adult education program called the Stryker Center. And they're doing daily classes. And they have students from Australia, from New Zealand, from all over the world. And suddenly, the world has gotten very small virtually, even though we're not anywhere near each other.
Yeah, definitely.
You know, Elinor, I'm really curious to know how COVID has changed art and music, both for the artist and for us as the audience.
Well, it's changed who the audience is. I think that's what we were just talking about, right? Is it's opened up an expansive audience that nobody ever imagined that they would have. So, I mean, so this program right now, for all we know, when it's aired, the person listening to it is going to be in Tel Aviv, or maybe they'll be in Australia. And so it's changed the audience. I think it's harder for the creators though. You know, I mean, everybody with me is in a kind of collective creative field. And it's very hard when you're used to a collective field to not have that collective energy. I also think, as I mentioned before, I think the institutions that we have counted on to support us, many of them are going to collapse. Mm-hmm. They're not going to have any money. I mean, let's be very clear about this. As the economy collapses, we know that nonprofits are in trouble. I mean, synagogues are in trouble if they can't have high holiday services. And if Broadway cannot open for many months, it's the same thing. So I think those of us for whom creative pursuit is commerce, have a real problem.
What is the future of Jewish content? And Elinor, Jess, I'm really curious, you know, what can we expect for more Jewish stories?
Who knows? No, I'm sorry. No, that was just being flipped. I think, you know, this is also a moment at the same time, like something like the Seder was funny. This is also a time of people, there's a lot of introspection. People are scared. And that takes you back to what your core identities are. And for many of us, that's being Jewish. So it might mean that we want to make bad Jewish jokes and bake challah, but it also means in terms of content that people are looking for a connection that makes them feel more grounded. What is grounding me right now? What is grounding any of us? It's not our friends, because we can, I mean, it is, but we can't see them, we can't hug them. So I think that's what Saturday Seder really reminded us of, is it was pride, because I think we all felt enormously proud. And it was connectedness. And then it was also a little bit of shoving off for the guy. Let's be very clear. And that was also pride.
But you know what it made? There was also this sense, I felt this overwhelming, you know, you talk about pride, that no matter what we have been through as Jews, figured out a way to do that Seder, you know?
And we left.
Huh?
And we left
because God only knows.
It was Diana.
And that's what my mother always said, you know, if we weren't laughing, we'd be crying. Ew.
Yeah.
And I mean, has Passover ever been so relatable too? I mean, like, we're literally in a plague right now, and it was just like, damn it, like, I get it. We're all sitting in our most comfortable chair in pajamas because we can't leave. And yeah, nobody can find yeast because everybody's baking. So sure, let's eat matzah. Like, it has never been more relatable. But I think that as far as, you know, creating more Jewish content or creating any content that is about minorities, what I'm fascinated to see right now is that because there are so many avenues kind of opening from like small to large, we're seeing that the gatekeepers are not able to keep that gate closed for a lot of like minority stories. I think there's going to be less curation, and I think it's going to be way more possible for us to tell our personal stories, our Jewish stories, LGBTQ stories, people of color stories, because it's going to be like, hey, this is me. And people are going to be like, hey, that's me too. And I think it's going to be so fascinating to see what that brings, because what I think the biggest thing for me and the biggest thing that I want to get out there is that as we're all going through quarantine, if you're lucky enough to be stuck at home and that's the worst thing that is happening to you, which we all know that it doesn't apply to the entire world, you are turning to the arts, you are watching Netflix, you are listening to music, like everybody is literally looking at our work, which is amazing, but let's not forget that, you know, it's everybody needs it in their lives, and that's what's keeping most of the population sane. So let's keep creating content because that's what we need to do.
Well, we have come to the end of this incredible panel, but I want to thank you guys so much.
Thank you, Brandon.
Yes, thank you, Brandon.
Thank you.
And it was so nice seeing everyone. I love you all.
I know it's like it's like we're together.
I know.
Wow.
Thank you so much.
Thanks, Brandon. Thank you, Beth.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Shabbat shalom, Beth.
Edwin Catmull wrote in Creativity Incorporated, visual polish doesn't matter if you're getting the story right. Hopefully tonight we got the story right. The story that even in these difficult and dark days, the light of creativity shines and inspires. It makes these days better and gives us hope for a beautiful future. That the timeline of Jewish history in its highs and its lows has never impeded our creativity. And in this time of isolation, we find ways to connect as we never imagined. Ben Platt of Dear Evan Hansen fame, along with his brothers Jonah and Henry, took to YouTube to post a beautiful arrangement of Ahavat Olam by Gabe Mann and Piper Rutman. Thanks to Jonah for giving us permission to end our program with this video and the sentiment behind the prayer they sing. Ahavat Olam reminds us that God's love is there for us in the good times and the bad times. Good night and stay safe.
Ahavat Olam, Beit Yisrael, Amcha Ahavta, Torah u'mitzvot, Chukim u'mishpatim, Otanu limadeta. Ahavat Olam, Beit Yisrael, Amcha Ahavta, Torah u'mitzvot, Chukim u'mishpatim, Otanu limadeta.
Yesh mifras lavan ba'or